So we actually did ask a lot of legal questions. Someone said he's not a lawyer in the room. Was it Martin? Yeah, it was you. So we have a lawyer, almost. Actually, Karine is working on law and specifically on the law behind and above and around the fight against botnets. So and she offered to make a presentation specifically on that issue. You're doing your PhD work on that or something like that? Yes, exactly. So Karine, you have the floor. Thank you.
Okay, thank you. Hello, my name is Karine, as was introduced by Eric, and I am a legal researcher at the BC Centre, which is the Belgian Centre for Excellence in Training on Cybercrime, at the KU Leuven University, also in Belgium, and I'm also a PhD candidate at Tilburg University in Tilburg, the Netherlands. And my presentation is about legal issues related to the disruption of botnets. And I believe this is of very much interest to anyone in this audience today. And the goal is not to explore any sort of the technical background of what happened there, but provide a legal perspective. So that's why the title, The Legal Behind the Scenes. So I want to present you with what actually happens from a law enforcement perspective when it comes to, you know, disrupting a botnet. I don't call it takedown, takeover, because, well, there are many variations there, but let's just call it disruption because that's what we see mostly nowadays. And it's a bit of a difficult scenario to explore because, I mean, we have seen many disruptions, many recent disruptions, basically some of them led in by the US, by US law enforcement, some big international consortiums working together. And we also see like some countries taking, I mean, more efforts, individualized efforts, as we saw the Netherlands with Bredolab, as we saw some botnet disruptions in Spain and so and so. So when it comes to the point of that I'm trying to make today, I'm looking at Game Over Zeus and Cryptolocker disruption, which happened in June of this year, and it was led by US law enforcement and by the Bredolab case, which is actually from 4 years ago. And by looking at these two disruptions, I'm actually trying to understand three questions. How did this happen? So what actually happens? Because, I mean, you have a lot of intelligence gathering, you find out how the botnet works, but how does, you know, prosecution, investigation actually goes on? Why, I mean, these disruptions were possible? Because, I mean, there's so many other botnets being reported to the police, and it looks like nobody's doing anything about them. So what makes these cases different from, you know, the other ones that are on standby? And what makes the Dutch jurisdiction different from the US jurisdiction? And that's more of a legal perspective there, but I think it's very important to highlight why some systems go faster and some other systems are taking a little bit longer to get there. It's kind of an unfair comparison, right? Because I call it comparing apples and oranges because, well, first technical difference would be that in the US you have a common law system, and in the Netherlands you have a civil law system, which is basically the continental European and which probably applies to most of you guys today. And the difference is that, I mean, from a practical perspective, the common law system is a little bit more flexible. It's fairly based on jurisprudence and, you know, case law, while in civil law things are more traditional, and they try to, you know, reuse the law that's already there and try to not amend things too much. So apples and oranges, because besides this, you know, very standard tradition, we also talk about different data protection systems, different privacy systems, different criminal law systems, different criminal procedure systems, different mandates. So it's basically everything is actually different. And I'm gonna start with the Game Over Zeus case. As you know, Game Over Zeus was actually, it was very, very much widespread, right? So what happened was that Before the disruption that happened this year, the FBI was actually investigating Game Over Zeus for over 2 years. And they had special agents like collecting information and everything they could about it. And what happened is that the FBI kind of collected all that was to know about the operation of the botnet, as well about its sensors, and then presented this information to the US government. And of course, other actions followed from that. But what is the particular characteristic that we are looking at here? I mean, Game Over Zeus was so widespread that it's, I mean, there are so many victims all over the world. Why was the US the first one to attempt disrupting it? You know, what, let's say, successfully did it? If there were so many other victims in the UK, in Australia, in China, why was it there? Why nobody did anything before? So basically, I mean, the first thing would be to point out this. The FBI was already gathering a lot of information about this for a very long time. And if you think about it, maybe it's not such a responsive and fast system because you take 2 years to study a botnet before you actually can do something about it. And what happened was that the US Attorney General started a complaint at the Western District Court of Pennsylvania. This complaint was followed by a request of a temporary restriction order, and this was granted. Therefore, the botnet was, the malicious connections were terminated, and in the end of the day, we had an arrest order issued to get the gang behind it. So I think that a couple things were crucial to this disruption. If you want to have some more details into how it actually happened, you know, the legal step by step, the US Justice Department made all this available, so you can just Google like Justice Department US and, you know, Game Over Zeus, and it will all be there. So I think the first key aspect there was the FBI itself. I mean, when you think about the FBI, it kind of like, it's a little bit different from the police, I would say, from the Netherlands, because there is just so much intelligence behind these agents, in the sense that they are given a certain mandate that, you know, regular police would maybe not have the power to do so. And they used some mechanisms, you know, that were traditional for law enforcement, you know, wiretapping and so and so, for which they probably needed some court orders. But at the same time, their mechanisms were way more invasive when you go look at it. They used some sort of mechanisms to kind of like, you know, really monitor all the traffic between the servers and the bots, which I think it would be very debatable in continental Europe if you think about, you know, the minimum standards that we have in data protection here and privacy law at large. But they were able to do so, you know, and because they have this more flexible, like broad mandate, they were able to gather all this information that made the life of, you know, prosecutors and the Attorney General much easier. Following from that, I think the US law enforcement, particularly in this case, they made three very smart moves, you know, as I call it. And this is, I mean, all this presentation is based on my personal perspectives and opinions. So I think the first smart move was the jurisdictional power and how they play with it. One of the biggest issues when it comes to cybercrimes that, you know, law enforcement is attached to territoriality. And that basically means that a state has its sovereignty and, you know, its powers are limited to that territory, of course. And when you think about cybercrime, that this structure just doesn't work because, you know, in the case of CryptoLocker, you had a guy who was Russian with some people working in Russian in Ukraine, and he never really stepped in the US, but his actions were affecting people in the US. So, I mean, if you think about, you know, if you think on that perspective, like if US jurisdiction has the power to prosecute a guy who never entered their territory, is living abroad, you know, maybe did not directly target that country in itself, but just overspread a certain malware, like everybody else in the world would be able to prosecute the same guy, right? And we have a certain principle in criminal law that forbids people to be prosecuted for the same crime twice or, you know, three times, whatever. So in that sense, the US played a certain role in the sense that they knew how to play with this jurisdictional limitation. So when it comes to US law, there are two aspects that need to be taken into consideration. Was to ascertain, is this court competent to, you know, to decide on this case? So the first thing is to decide on the subject matter, and the other is the personal jurisdiction. The subject matter in the case of Game Over Zeus was very much related to the money laundering, you know, and all the financial fraud that was going on, because it was a credential harvester, you know, exploiting some Swift vulnerabilities and, you know, making wire transfers all over the world, millions and millions. So the Attorney General, the US Attorney General, actually decided, well, I'm gonna play this, you know, with the bank and wire fraud and unlawful access, you know, to electronic communications. And of course, I mean, he could have gone other ways, but that was the reason why he did that. And it's, I believe, and that I think it's because these same provisions gave him the power to initiate this action in any federal court in the US. So he was basically, you know, forum shopping. He was like, I can start whatever I want. And why did he do that? Because personal jurisdiction, which is the other limit of this thing, says that you know, to prosecute a certain person, a foreigner, you need to consider the long arm statute of a certain state in the US. And they actually decided to start this action in Pennsylvania, because the statute of Pennsylvania gave them the possibility of prosecute a foreigner located in the outside, you know, had never entered the US, and so and so. So everything was pretty much planned, because, I mean, of course, there were several people affected in Pennsylvania, but there were, I mean, all more people in the rest of the US. Not only that, those specific provisions gave this Attorney General the possibility of requesting the court a temporary, you know, a prompt injunction on stopping all these malicious activities. So I think they played it really, really smart. The second smart move, I would say, was the innovative character of this disruption. When you look at the speech given by, you know, the people, the law enforcement people that working in this case, they say, like, we try to merge, you know, some traditional legal techniques with some kind of modern ways to approach it, because we know that, you know, to prosecute cybercrime nowadays with the laws of yesterday, it's kind of a very challenging thing. So what they did was, what I think was just, you know, very, very innovative from my perspective, was how do you notify, you know, a defendant whose identity you kind of know? They knew one of the people, they knew the name. They were not so sure about the address, but they kind of had it. And for the other people, they had emails, nicknames, and stuff like that. So that's kind of tricky, because, you know, in cybercrime, of course, you have the issue with the anonymization, but in criminal law, you need to have some certain attribution. You need to individualize the, you know, the defendant and the suspect of a crime. In the US, you do have some cases, you know, with Joan Doe's and things like that, where the person is not actually known. But that imposes a very a high threshold when you talk about the right to defense, because anyone has, everybody actually, has the right to a defense. That means that person has the right to present, you know, a proper defense that will enable that person to, you know, prove innocence. So if that person is not actually, you know, sufficiently informed that there is a, you know, a complaint going on in the other side of the world, how is he supposed to present his defense? So what the US did was to use a precedent that was going on in the CoreFlood case, which was another disruption. And what the Attorney General proposed was four ways. They actually suggested that they would, you know, kind of notify him physically in his last known location in Russia. The other way was to email him. And the third way was to, you know, fill in the emails that were registered in the domain names of the botnet. You know, and the fourth way was to upload a message on the FBI and on the Department of Justice webpage. So if you think about a very, you know, traditional criminal law regime, this, I mean, besides the first one, which could be considered, the other three ones are just like very random and very, like, very shocking somehow, you know, because do they actually provide the opportunity for the defender to present his defense and to prove his innocence. If that wouldn't be done, how would the general attorney proceed? So I think that was quite innovative. It was a very smart way of thinking, and the court accepted it. Secondly, they asked for this very broad restraining order and preliminary injunction. So they basically asked to divert all the traffic that was going to the server, to establish a new server where they would, you know, receive all the communication with the bots, and to be able to look at the information of these victims to enable disinfection later on. And I mean, from a data protection perspective, I think this is very, very highly intrusive. But when it comes to a fundamental right as data protection, I mean, nothing is, you know, absolute. So you have to think of some ways in which this could be balanced against the need for security, which was at stake. However, this was also granted by the court. However, if you think strictly about what criminal law says about